My name is Lars Albertsson, and I've done a bunch of things in my life, just like most people. Last few years, I've been working as an independent consultant, helping people or helping companies get value from the data through like data processing, technical solutions, and with like strategic management consulting regarding data as well. I'm also the founder of a company called Memeria, and we do something we call data value as a service. So it's an outsourcing partnering solution that you can use instead of building your own data lake, your own data platform. So we take custody of your data, extract the value in forms of recommendations, and so forth, and fraud detection, reports, whatever you want. And of course, this is all GDPR compliant, since it's GDPR Spring, which brings us to the topic of the presentation. How do you actually get value from data, and how can you both get value from data and be compliant with GDPR? I started working with technical privacy protection a few years ago, and when I went out to find resources, this is roughly what I found. I found a lot of legal talk with a lot of threats about high fines, and I found a lot of vendors that say, if you just use our product, everything is much better. What I could not find was the resources on how to build these systems from a technical perspective, how to build into the data processing system a way to protect privacy, what the GDPR called privacy by design. So I decided to make the presentation myself and sort of present the toolbox that I've learned in working in a number of companies with GDPR protection or GDPR compliance. There are a number of different areas that you need to cover in order to be compliant, illustrated in this picture. The scope of this presentation is mostly technical, but also to some degree culture. I should say that this is a short version of a longer presentation, and in the last slide I have a link to the longer presentation. Video and slides are online. So if we look at it from a software engineering perspective, the things that you have to prepare for and care about are listed here. The most difficult one is the right to be erased or the right to be forgotten. How do you actually store your data so that you can just go in and erase individual users? And that's what a lot of focus in this presentation will be on. Now, why is this difficult? If you go back in time to the early days of the web, this is kind of what web applications looked like at the time. You had people with the web browsers connected to some kind of service. The service had a database, and all the data in the system was stored in that database. So if you wanted to know something, you just went to the database. If you wanted to erase something, you also went to the database. So forgetting about users or figuring out what you knew about users was fairly straightforward. Now, things have changed, and in the big data era, we're not so much centered around databases anymore. Instead, we're centered around events. So we store everything that has ever happened in our application since the dawn of time. We pour this into a data lake, and from the data lake, from the raw zone in the data lake, we make like refinement pipelines. And we do this for a good reason. Before there were data lakes and Hadoop and things, there were some things that were difficult to do, and the things that we could do took much longer time. So this event-oriented and pipeline-oriented data processing structures, they have enabled companies to be very disruptive, and they have enabled things like machine learning to actually go out into production. So we're not going to give these things up. If you zoom out a bit, look at it at scale. This is kind of what it looks like. All of the data that you have in the source system on the left, you collect into to a raw zone in the data lake, or raw zone or cold store. And ideally, if it wasn't for privacy, you would just keep it there forever because disk is cheap nowadays. From that, Rawson, you build these refinement pipelines that do the recommendations, do reporting, and so forth. And in the end, on the right-hand side, you when you have created artifacts out of value, such as recommendation indexes or roll-up cubes, you push them out into some egress storage that is more suitable for serving. If you somebody went to the Klarna presentation, this is roughly what they're doing as well, described from a slightly different angle. How many people feel that this is what they're doing in their organization or would like to do? So a few hands. This is interesting. I held this presentation at Berlin Buzzwords last year, which is a like very techy big data conference, and everybody raised their hands. So that you know now where the wind is blowing. Almost every company that you consider as a disruptive on the global stage do this kind of have these kinds of architecture in one form or another. So in order for this to work out well, there are some principles that you have to. You have immutable data. You don't once it goes into the lake, you don't touch it. You don't mutate it, ideally. And even in the later pipeline stages, you don't mutate data. You just like transform it to something new. You do things many times. You make many copies of the data for like reliability and for reproducibility for machine learning experiments and so forth, and for redundancy because these systems are made out of like fragile components that where you compensate by doing things multiple times. So this is great from a technical perspective, not so great from a privacy perspective, because deleting things suddenly becomes very hard. So what can you do about it? There are different kinds of things you can do. You can change the technology and architecture so that it becomes possible or feasible to remove things. And you can work with the culture to make people aware, and you can sort of do the in-between thing and make it easy for people to do the right thing. One thing that you need to do is to classify your data, and that classification of your data, whether data sets or data items are personal or not, need to go down to the very low level so that it's visible to the developers. And my clients and in multiple companies, it's common to see like color classifications, but there are other ways as well. It usually ends up being like three or four different classes with very not sensitive data at all, that's not personal, things that are tied to a person, and things that are sensitive in one way or another and tell something about the person, such as income or GPS location or whatever. This is just an example. The exact classification depends on your application domain. So one thing we did at a company was to create like a gateway tool. If somebody has used the cloud environments like AWS or Google Cloud, they're familiar with these AWS command line tools or gcloud command line tools. So we made a similar tool internal for the company. This turned out to be good for like integrity and privacy because people started using that tool instead of the corresponding cloud tools, which gave us a point to like steer the behavior of people and log what the data scientists were doing and so forth. So it was a point of governance that enabled us to do some things for privacy. Now, I thought that the data scientists wouldn't like that. It turned out to be the other way around. They actually felt very enabled with it because this tool had no business logic whatsoever. It was just hardwired configuration. It knew about the location of our production Spark clusters or the experimentation Spark clusters, and it gave the data scientists who were not so super good at operations, it gave them a catalog of things that you could do. It turned out that they could do a lot more than if they had all of the cloud's capabilities at their disposal, because they now knew which things were like supported by the data infrastructure team. So shortly thereafter, some manager wanted a presentation or whatever, and we had to cap the size of the Spark clusters to 100 nodes so that data scientists would spin them up all over. A few weeks passed, And then it was announced that there was now a person responsible for cost control. So I thought that was a great achievement that we managed to burn so much cloud money that they had to cap that. So I've seen a couple of different strategies on how to technically protect privacy in the data lake and the data processing. One strategy that I would not recommend is to like anonymize and scramble things on their way in so that you only have like anonymized or pseudonymized data in the data lake. It's kind of simple to implement, but it really disables many of the things that you want to do with the data. And also, it turns out not to really protect privacy all that well. So what I instead recommend is to do privacy protection when you take things out of the data lake. So you technically like seal the data lake and make it inaccessible to most people. But if you make it as like a self-service environment, you can still allow people to build their own data lines and launch them inside the data lake to get the data out that they want. So now on to the art of forgetting things. Like if you don't plan for how to forget people or forget information, it will spread out all over your data lake. And I've seen this happen. It's very expensive to recover from that mistake. So one thing you can do is to discard personal data. That's the easiest thing. And you can either completely anonymize data and replace, throw away information. You have, for example, you have a page view or a song that has been played. If you throw away the information about the user, so you don't know who played it, it's anonymized. Then you can't do all that much. So there's a compromise called pseudonymization, where you replace the real ID of the user with like a technical ID that can only be viewed internally. So you have a pseudonymous user that has done all of these things, but you don't really know who it is. And you can make this in different ways. You can make it so it's very predictable. So you have this, for example, if you don't want to do recommendations, you might want to have the same pseudonymous user and have a history of what films he has watched or whatever, so you can still do recommendations to him. Or you can add a bit of some salt, which is a cryptographic technique to sort of mask data and get limited value of it. That depends on your use case. So when you need to forget people, you need to remove them from the source data set and then from all of the other data sets as well. One way to do this is to, like, from the source, do recomputation of everything that's downstream. This is difficult to get right because you really have to have a strong governance in your data lake, and you need to have a culture of coordination in the company. Most companies don't have that. This is Google's main strategy, but they are a very coordinated company. It probably won't work for most companies. So a more common solution is to never copy the personal data around. Instead, you extract the personal data when data arrives in your data lake, and you put it in a separate like PII table. And then you just have links to this table. And when you want to forget a person, you just throw away that particular entry in the table, which contains all of the PII. And all of the other data sets just has a dangling link, so you can't get information about the user. There's a variation of this, where you, instead of put the data in the link, you encrypt the data and copy the encrypted data around everywhere, and you have this, instead in the table, you put the decryption key. So when a user wants to be forgotten, you throw away the decryption key. You still have the encrypted data, but you cannot decrypt it back, so you have practically forgotten the user. This is requires more of the tools. This doesn't work so well in SQL-based environments because they don't have built-in decryption functions. So it works better in environments with Spark or similar tools. On the other hand, it gives better security because if you have a breach, then you cannot leak this juicy table of PII data. You need to. The intruder needs to get both the encrypted data and the keys in order to have value out of it. In practice, you also need to tell all the systems around the data lake that somebody has been forgotten or should be forgotten. So you need to like publish what's called a tombstone line. These are the people that we want to be erased from everywhere. So that the other systems can react on it. For example, if you have recommendation databases, they should evict a particular user. Some things that you should never do, which will get you into trouble. Using personal data as technical keys in your system, or as primary keys. This will get you into a lot of trouble when you want to change the data model to support privacy by design. I've seen an example of this where the username was used as key everywhere, and the username, since it's chosen by the user, is privacy sensitive data. That is the most expensive engineering mistakes that I've seen. It took at least like 10 engineering years to get to recover from that, and tons of data processing. Now, this is ironic because many companies use like Swedish personal numbers, personnummer, as keys, and they were designed to be keys from the beginning, but that's something you shouldn't do. Also, if you should never publish things that contain PII data, and this is also fairly common. You can see like people's public profiles with their recommended list or their playlists and so forth that actually contain PII data in the URL and so forth. And you shouldn't publish data sets that you think might be anonymized, but they're actually only pseudonymized, because there you can do attacks to figure out which users actually are referred to. And there has been some like spectacular examples of this. Okay, I'm faster than I usually am, apparently. There are actually a few good sources on information out there. I like the Article 29 Working Party. They make like good comprehensible text about the how to interpret the GDPR. You have to. Some of them go into too deep into data science to be practical, so you have to take them with a grain of salt. And both the UK equivalent of Datainspektionen, which is linked here, and the Irish one, which is not in this list, are also good sources. And if you want to see the longer version of this presentation, you go to the top slide here.